public talks are maybe not the easiest to get to. We're honored and it's a pleasure to have Carolyn Mish from the Northampton Planning Office give us some sense of what the future of Northampton might be in some critical areas such as transportation, green space, etc. A tiny bit of background and then we'll have the talk. It's been just over a year that we started a contemporary art series at Historic Northampton where the artist engages with a collection of Historic Northampton. Chester Michalik, whose work is on the walls, is with us, and after the show, Chester will stay on, and if you have any questions, Chester would be happy to spend some time with you. And after our official question and answer period, Carolyn, too, will stay on if you have some informal questions you'd like to talk about. And are there any more people on the way?
One person yes. coming in.
Do you want the light down?
We have seats right up here. We have another one here. Okay. Carolyn Mish, thank you for coming.
Thank you for that introduction. And I'd just like to reiterate that pleasantly surprised to see so many of you, lots of familiar faces and some not familiar faces. But so I guess what I'd like to talk about is the title is obviously Contemporary Northampton 2030. But sort of wrapping into that, how the past has influenced where we are now and how that's informing what we need to do. From a community perspective and as it relates to planning, which is my job with the city of Northampton, sort of where we are and what direction we need to head to achieve some sustainability goals for long-term livability and resiliency in the community. And so I'm gonna, several of my slides sort of look at the past and what sort of the established framework from which we are, where we are now and where we need to head or what kind of alterations we might look at making to address the changes around us that deal with demographic shifts that are occurring locally, statewide, as well as nationally, and how those shifts are changes from the past trends and how we'll need to make changes based on those demographic shifts into the future. And 2030 really isn't that far away in terms of, and certainly from a planning perspective, 16 years from hence. And change from what, in terms of what we do, is very incremental. It takes a long time to sort of think, have community sessions, think about where we want to go as a community, then establish some guidelines for how we get there. Maybe there's specific projects that we feel are important to create, and what we're working from now is Sustainable Northampton, which is a long-range comprehensive plan about how the community should be shaped or tweaked or reshaped into the future to address the changing environment around us. And so, I've been with the city since 2000, and we started planning on projects and ways that we might address some of these changes. And we're just now seeing some of those things come to fruition. And so when I think about 2030, I know we're starting to design things now that I know that we either won't have funding to do as a community for several years, and we certainly need to design and do those things. So, there might not be that much change in reality because they come in little baby steps, and I'm going to go through some of those slides that describe that in more detail. But again, sort of the basic focus of my discussion is sort of the sustainability aspects that we're looking for as a community to try to address related to transportation, open space, and green infrastructure. Land use and urban form changes that will meet those sustainability goals. So let me go ahead and start. I'll turn this on here. So, again, sort of what we did in the past or how we reformed in the past informs how we move forward and what kind of things we need to address. So, you can see the pictures, courtesy of Historic Northampton. I actually don't know the date, and somebody might here might know, but we've got a horse and buggy here, so I think that's a pretty good indicator. But you can see Main Street is very wide, and it's been that way since the time these buildings were built. So that's what we have. That's the framework that we need to deal with in terms of all of the other changes around us that have happened. Technology, we're not using these mechanisms anymore to get around. but also through time, you know, you can see the walkways are really pretty much flush with the road. So the railroad came along, and just out of this picture down here is the railroad bridge, not far from where we are in this room. And then cars came along, and trucks, and bigger vehicles. Well, they couldn't get under the railroad bridge, so we had to have this massive project to lower this road so that cars could get under the bridge. The result of that is that now we have, in some places along the courthouse and then down farther south on Main Street, really tall curves, and not very good for all kinds of pedestrians that we serve in Northampton. So it takes a long time to sort of address those changes and think about what impacts did lowering the road really have on all the other systems around us. So we're still dealing with this. We still have these really tall granite steps in places that aren't so accommodating for people, for everyone in the community. We also have changing demographics that influence in terms of transportation, where we want to go, what's important, how do we get people from place to place, or how do we make sure that people are living in the place that they want to get to very easily. And we've seen over time, and this is not just a local phenomenon, but it's really happening all over, is that there's a demand for people to be close to where they need to go for goods and services. They want to be able to walk places. We are an aging community, and that's happening. That's, of course, a trend overall nationwide, as well as in the Commonwealth. And we have more single people demanding smaller housing units, but in places where they can walk and not have to rely on always on the automobile, which has sort of been, so it's a shift in the trend from the mid-century up to now. So citywide, citywide, our household average size is 2.1 persons per household, and we have a school-age population, 10%. That's much lower than we were even 15, 20 years ago. And we've broken that data down even further so that we know that downtown neighborhoods around downtown, for example, are under 2 persons per household. So we know that people, you know, we're having fewer children, and people are waiting longer to have children, and they're living in areas closer to downtown. And versus the newer outlying suburban areas is where we really have the highest population, persons per household population size. And so that's going to influence where we're looking for trying to meet the needs of those different population sectors. And what's also interesting, I think, about these figures is that typically, I think people tend to think that for multifamily homes, there's lots of children. So when you have multifamily complexes, it's going to be filled with people and lots of kids. And that's just not panning out now. It's not what we're seeing as a trend. So there may be more units in a place, but there's certainly less smaller population size. So again, sort of going back to what we're dealing with the past built environment, it stays with us for a long time. So if we're thinking about how we're going to meet the demands for the changing demographics, this is another picture slightly later in time. Obviously, we have cars. They're still pretty slow moving. There's also a streetcar now in the middle of the downtown Northampton. We still have a very wide space to deal with. But now, in 2014, and has been for a while, our cars don't look like this. They go much faster, and they want to get places very quickly. But we also have a lot more pedestrians and people in the downtown area, for example. And these maps over here show these little dots. I don't know if you can see them. But these are our crash points where we have pedestrian, bicycle, and vehicular accidents. And so we've had this bubble around downtown. This is Pleasant Street here, King Street up here, and then Main Street along here. We've got lots of high sort of crash sites, or incident sites. And this goes out a little bit further up out of downtown. So these are the pinch points, basically, that we have to address. And we're taking sort of a wide network and trying to figure out what do we do today to address all of those issues. And one of the things that we've been working on, and again, it goes back to this incremental understanding of incremental change, is that for many years we've planned and tried to expand the bike path system and the bike path network. So in the upper photos you see we have the nice pedestrian overpasses over Main Street to get people from one side.
Just quickly here.
Okay.
Apologies.
Okay. Alright. But these were plans starting 15 years ago. So in 1999, we started thinking about how can we branch off of the Norwalk Rail Trail that goes to Amherst. And so for a long time, all we had was the Northampton Rail Trail and the Norwalk, and nothing really connected anywhere except for on that spine. And it took a number of years to design and then actually get funding. And those funding cycles come and go, and sometimes we're successful and sometimes we're not, until finally we really get a big big grant funding source and we're able to complete more of that network. So what we've started is the rail trail network, but the next and bicycle lanes within the street network. So if you see painted lines or bike symbols on the roads, that's what we've been working towards in terms of accommodating different modes of transportation other than just the automobile. But we're taking sort of, we're looking at that, well, how can we expand on that? So the next step is to create what we're calling, and what's been used in other places, cycle tracks, which is more of an elevated on-road but up above elevated sort of tracks, if you want to think about it as a sidewalk but for bikes, right next to the travel lane, and looking at ways we can further improve safety of people who are traveling by bicycle and still accommodate automobiles, because we know that's not going to go away by 2030, it's probably not going to go away by 2050 or ever. So so we're looking at cycle tracks and also trying to accommodate, sort of retrofit all of those wide streets. And it's not just Main Street and Pleasant Street, but if you think of the network between downtown Northampton and Florence and Locust Street, is a tremendously wide road, and people are going to want to go, and they want to go now, and we have a bike path for that. But from downtown Northampton to downtown Florence and all those neighborhoods that connect, we want to make sure we're accommodating people to walk and bike or skateboard or what have you on those road segments. So how do we make those accommodating for all those modes and create what we're calling complete streets, so that we're addressing all those different ways of getting places? And so as part of that impetus to try to get to a place where we're accommodating all modes of traffic, we've started the very first bit of design, and this takes years and years, but we had, I don't know if any of you, some of you were probably part of this charrette that we had, I think it's almost 2 years ago now, to look at how we could retrofit Main Street to accommodate more people using, walking and biking and in fact, there are narrow sidewalks that don't even accommodate wheelchairs very well. So we need to make sure that all of those folks can use downtown. So this is sort of a quick, so out of that charrette, we did this quick design of this is Main Street, this is City Hall here, so just to orient you, historic Northampton is down on this end, and then Smith College is over here. And this is South Street and State Street down here. This intersection here is, as you know, is a very complicated one for people driving, walking, trying to cross. And then this corner is very dangerous here. Well, we've started to look at how can we readjust the way we park along Main Street? How can we take more of that real estate that's allocated to the road for other uses? And as you know, there's more and more demand for outside cafe space. But there's only, right now, the sidewalk is too narrow to accommodate all the people who are walking on the sidewalks and the people who want to dine on the sidewalk. So, you know, part of this is also addressing business development and making it more friendly for people to be able to, or to have places to stop and rest and sit and have coffee or get something to eat. So reallocating the space for, widening the sidewalk that would accomplish more sidewalk space for all of those different business uses and pedestrian uses, as well as creating it safer for people who are trying to cross the street because it narrows the width of the pavement, and also people who might be traversing along the road that are not in a car. So we start with these, brainstorms and these designs, and I have another slide that goes into a little bit more detail, but the concept for complete streets is really just sort of think about what real estate you have and figure out how you can reallocate some of that space. And so this is going into more detail about this intersection, and I'm talking about this because I think, I'm hoping that this will be done by before 2030. Because this has been a problem intersection of State Street and Elm coming into Maine, and then South Street for a very long time. We had a death last year down in this area, and for many DPW directors, this has been a problem intersection that hasn't been able to be solved yet. So, we look at what we need to look at, sort of those users who are in the network and the people who are walking to downtown from those adjacent neighborhoods, and how do you get them safely across. And we need to be designing, we know, for walking speeds of 2 to 4 feet per second. So what this means for this is about a 75-foot span. So you need 20 to 30 seconds to cross that, and I don't know of any walk signal that's that long for any of these intersections. And the same here, very long. You really need a long walk cycle here. So how do we fix this? And we've begun to design this, and we have a consultant working with us to address that. But then, so we're in design now and sort of thinking about that, but then it's going to take a whole nother pot of resources to actually fix it once we have the design. I'm hoping it won't be until that long, that far out in the future. But so this is sort of the concept that we've come up with, and this is applicable to a lot of these intersections and those problem points that I showed you on the map. Is the idea is really to narrow the dimension along which people have to walk and create other ways of people getting through the road network for transportation purposes. So make it easier for people to get to where they want to go without having to get into a car. So this is actually essentially, we have this now, it's a bike path, but it's sort of green stripes, sort of the bike right of way, the bike lane here. And then the gray are islands, new islands that would be put in place to create safe havens, essentially, for crossing this. So it reduces the amount, the gap that people need to walk to get to a place that's safe. and thereby reducing that time it takes, and so then you can readjust your traffic signals to allow to accommodate the cars that are going through here. So it's really about sort of narrowing these spaces so that you have a safe place to go, and that instead of having, and then you can get from this corner to this corner instead of trying to do two crossings just to get over to this building, let's say, if you're coming from a neighborhood from down the street. So this is just an example of how we would look at creating safer spaces for people. And then this bike lane would continue on into downtown and again create sort of, take some of this real estate that's all been allocated to cars. So, and going back a little bit to this sort of sketch of how we might deal with further up Main Street in front of City Hall, Stan and I were talking earlier before people came about, we touched a little bit about the rainbow crosswalk conflagration, I guess I would say, discussion in the community. But this over here is really just a student project that I did a one studio class for a design class in Amherst. And so the students came up with this concept of narrowing the street here, but putting art, I guess this would have to go through the Arts Council for approval, but we'd create a process for that to happen. But the idea is create something visual in the street so that it's a cue to the driver. So they're going to be focused on that crosswalk, so they're going to see people. It'll be easier for people to be seen as they're crossing, but also narrow this. So this is I'm sure all of you have been trying to go around this corner in driving, but also being a pedestrian trying to cross, and you can't really see who's coming around the corner. So this is another problem area that we're really, we're hoping will also come sooner than later. And this is the graph, the quick and dirty sketch of it, but again, allocating more sidewalk space here for businesses and for people who want to go to those businesses. And really making more civic spaces in downtown, and that's what these green circles sort of represent, plaza areas that could be a focal point and take back some of that street real estate. So again, sort of to wrap up the transportation piece of it, the idea is to create what we're calling complete streets and what typically is the term called complete streets that really accommodates everyone who needs to use them to get to the places that they need to go. And these are just examples here of what it might look like. This is not in Northampton, but this is sort of where we're headed in terms of what intersections might look like in the near future. And this is an example of what we're trying to solve in terms of our new streets, is sort of also the idea of creating a shared street where people and all users are on the same plane, but everything is really slowed down to a point where it's safe to have cars and pedestrians using that same space, because you have things like trees that are impediments for cars to just dip through. Or you have cobbled streets, in this case, to slow traffic. And in terms of transit, I haven't talked that much about the rail coming, and hopefully that will be sooner than later so we can get those boxcars off the tracks. But, you know, here's a picture before the rail trail, and now we have a bike network here, and then on the other side of this is going to be the rail link to New Haven and New York. And that will not take till 2030. Hopefully that will be next year. According to the governor, that will be by the end of this year. So we'll see if that happens. So I just want to circle back a little bit on transportation. So we're going back to 1999. we were planning for some of these bike trails, and so it was a little bit more, it was a little fuzzier in terms of what benefits they would bring, because we didn't have the linkages to that main spine. I think now now we're actually serving about 75% of the population, and they've been wildly popular, and I think now more and more people are saying, okay, we need more of this stuff, and we need to be able to get to places. So our goal in 2030 is to serve almost 100% of the population with bike trails or lanes and other accommodations for people who are not driving their cars. In 1999, we had pedestrian signal was just in the design phases all across King Street. We have that now. We're working on the complete streets, and we're hoping that not just in downtown, but we're actually addressing all of these streets as we rebuild and retrofit these streets throughout the city, that we're taking that real estate and reallocating it for other ways, for other use. In terms of open space and green infrastructure, which I'll talk a little bit next, we started sort of looking back at 2000, 1999, about 10% of the city was allocated for open space. We're about 20% now, so we've about doubled. And we want to keep moving in that direction, and that serves sustainability goals for you know, resiliency in terms of absorption of runoff. We need to also provide for you know, working landscapes, farms, and just protection of our natural resources and ecological systems. And we also want to be mindful that we're serving different populations, different neighborhoods throughout the city, so it's not just in the western part of the community, but it's sort of scattered throughout, and that's always been a goal, but we've been working, we've been able to realize that goal more recently, so that's good. The other piece about green infrastructure, I'll explain that a little bit, it really means, sort of big picture, it means handling runoff at the site instead of piping rainwater out, off into ponds and through pipes and eventually to the river and forgetting about it and making it someone else's problem, you know, flooding down in Connecticut or what have you. So what we're really working on now is sort of how we retrofit those systems, where for a while we've been saying, oh, we just want to take the stormwater, handle it for a few minutes here, and then push it somewhere else. So we're working on slowly trying to get systems more prevalent throughout, and when we retrofit, we create mechanisms to do that, and that then leads to more resiliency as we try to deal with climate change and adaptation as well, because we're dealing with those shifts, environmental shifts, where we're going to be getting a lot more rainfall, like last night, all the time. And then I'll talk a little bit about land use and urban form and sort of where we've moved from looking at just downtown Northampton for design and how we've moved forward and what we'll be looking at more urban form issues and sort of urban form throughout the community in terms of design and how we allow new development to be consistent with and enhance those existing neighborhoods that we already have and that we know and love.
What was LID?
LID is low impact design, and it's really another term to sort of explain how you would, or to, it's utilized in designing infrastructure for managing stormwater that is less infrastructure intensive, so it's more on site, it's like rain gardens or creating little green spaces that capture that water on site. And I'll go into that a little bit. I know it's thrown up there as an acronym there. It's not clear. So, you know, when we talk about open space and conservation, there are a whole number of areas that are important for open space acquisition. And right now we have about 20% of our open space are in pristine areas that are ecologically rich. And so we have a conservation mission to protect those areas and to continue to protect those pristine areas and direct growth in other places that protect those. But we also want to make sure we're creating other kinds of open space that are beneficial to neighborhoods throughout the community, parks, and then, as I mentioned before, working landscapes for community gardens and farms, but also for commercial agriculture. And so, as I mentioned, you know, the goal for our conservation efforts and to sort of get to that 30% open space is really about the people in the community. And we want to make sure we're creating open space that is available for people to walk to. And so we're serving all of those neighborhoods, and it's about gardens and parks and recreational facilities. So we have Florence Fields is sort of our latest, biggest acquisition, and it serves working agriculture with, you know, a commercial farm, but also community gardens. And it's accessible. It's sort of the biggest acquisition that we have that really is in walking distance from Florence Center. We put a bike path and sidewalk in that connects to Florence Center. And that the goal there really was so people could easily get there without having to get in their car, people within walking distance of Florence. And we will continue to sort of work in that vein to acquire property that is in and around neighborhoods. We also, besides acquisition, the city looks at helping farmers protect their land through what we call agricultural preservation restrictions, and it's with the state, it's a partnership with the state. So essentially the development rights are purchased off of those land so that the pressure for development is taken off and the property owner gets some financial benefit from selling those development rights from the land, and then it's permanently protected for agricultural use. So we work on that end too, as opposed to just acquisition. And we're also mindful that we need to make sure that we're creating these spaces or allowing these spaces to continue in areas that are not traditionally served, or people who might not easily access farm stands or what have you. So we want to make sure those, again, are distributed as much as possible throughout the community. So I'm going to go into discussion in a little bit more detail about green infrastructure, because it really, it's probably the next big push that it ties all of this together, actually, the urban forum where we're going to be developing transportation networks will need to incorporate what we're calling green infrastructure, which is a different way of managing the runoff from these storm events, and really is probably the main way that we're going to be able to adapt to climate change. And so we've dabbled in this a little bit. You may not be aware, but when we built the senior center, we created a rain garden there, which is really a working storm water management system. And it may just look like, in this case, looks like dead shrubs and dead grass. But there's actually, this is early spring, so everything's, you know, been cleaned up and everything. But it actually does work to filter pollutants and slow water runoff before it goes into sort of the piped system. And so we started with that, and then up at Village Hill, we've also allowed, believe it or not, the way that we've built infrastructure, again, sort of from the, when we really were accommodating cars at higher speeds, we've always curbed the roadside, and those curbs direct runoff into a piped stormwater system. So now we're going back and we're saying, well, let's take those curbs away. Because really we don't, in some places, not in every place, but to the extent that we can take these curbs away, that offers opportunity to collect the water there on site instead of directing it into a pipe. And it will overall reduce the stress on the systems that are collecting lots of water. So we're at certain points, you may know, but we have surcharges through the system. We have a bad stormwater. There's really old pipes. We have problems down behind Bridge Street with, you know, 100-plus-year-old stormwater pipes and surcharging. And so surcharging meaning that there's too much water for the pipe, and so it just backs up and comes out onto the street and creates localized flooding. You probably read in the paper about the problems at the end of State Street. With flooding, that's not necessarily a recent problem. That actually was caused by the original construction, or was contributed to the original construction of the railroad. When the railroad went in, it sort of created a berm and pushed water in a different direction. But at any rate, anytime we can take some of that water away and hold it on site, so it's not going into being piped into sort of these main systems, we can reduce those surcharges and help overall the system. And then, so you may not even realize, but down on Conn Street, you'll notice these curb breaks. This is actually just pretty much a grass swale, which is a depression, but it was created on purpose to take runoff from the road. So there's a little inlet here and settle in here, recharge a bit, and hold that water back. So that's how the city has started down this path of trying to be more mindful of and adapt to these changes.
Where is that on Conn Street?
Well, the city rebuilt Conn Street a couple of years ago, maybe now. But this is, I think this is a Gazette right here. So in that area we have one, and I think further up there may be another one. And then we just did it again on North Street. When North Street was rebuilt, there were a few areas that look very similar to this where water's going to flow off the street into the swale and settle there. So these are sort of projects that have recently been undertaken by the city, but that's where we're moving. You will see a lot more of this as we try to adapt to climate change. This is what and we're also looking at this, and my last slide is going to be about our big project that we're pushing on. We talked about, we've worked a lot on gateways, the commercial gateways in Northampton, and the next push for gateway will be Pleasant Street. And we've talked a lot about what we can do. These pictures are not taken from Northampton. There are other places in urban areas where there have been retrofits for this stormwater system, and it not only creates a place for the water to flow, but it creates visual relief in the street network. So you can have trees in there, you can have different variety of plantings, you can put benches there, and it sort of softens the urban character of the street. So we're going to be looking at, in terms of Pleasant Street, we're going to see how we might be able to do this in pockets along the street if we get the opportunity to rebuild and address some of the issues on Pleasant Street, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. And this is our long-range land use plan map that was part of our Sustainable Northampton plan. And I'll just talk about this quickly, that the green areas are sort of, first let me talk about the orange areas are sort of the areas we want to concentrate development, and the gray and red is commercial areas. But these are really represent the core. This is downtown Northampton. We've got Florence here and then Leith up here. And the goal is really to encourage new growth to accommodate those demographic changes where people are looking for smaller houses close to walking distance and biking from services. Concentrate development in these areas. The darkest green represent lands that the city already has permanently protected. And this is the meadows. This is floodplain. So this has also been essentially, we don't allow any new residential development here because we want to keep people away from the flood prone areas. And then the light green just represents where, if we do have development, we already have neighborhoods. This is the Ryan Road neighborhood. This is the school. We want to be careful about how it's developed and protect the natural resources that are there. So we want to encourage a type of cluster development that would really protect most of the natural resources within properties, but allow some limited development. And then sort of looking at those areas where we're going to concentrate in development, the reason is that if we develop the way some of these neighborhoods were in the 50s and 60s, with this little small area that's 180 units is 64 acres of land versus 180 units closer to town, which covers 37 acres. And so the goal is, we don't want to be as land consumptive as we had been, and we want to make sure people have access to where they need to go. Out here, there's very limited infrastructure for people to get to places where they need to be going. This map has a lot of colors on it. I just want to briefly describe what we've been looking at in terms of trying to look at where we might encourage development and where there are opportunities. This black line represents a segment of Main Street, and we did these rings around Main Street. This is a quarter mile. And it's very easy for people to walk to their destination within a half a mile, particularly if it's a nice walk and there's an easy path to get there. So we sort of look at, we use this to sort of think about zoning and zoning pattern regulations that affect where and how and what type of development we want to encourage. The dark blue is a half mile radius, but it's just around this Main Street. And then we look at sort of service rings that are really along road networks that connect here. So what this, what we use this for is to sort of look at what makes sense for a zoning perspective, where we might want to encourage new development. And you may have heard or seen in the paper that Smith College is looking at, has been for many years, looked at selling its land holdings that it's not using for its core mission, which is education. And the Fort Hill campus off of South Street, which is, I have to orient myself, is, I'm going to get this wrong, I know, because I'm upside down here. It's somewhere over here. but anyway, it's over 100, over 100 acres, and it's right on the within this walk area. So that says to us, you know, we want to be careful about how that gets built. It's a huge amount of acreage, and it is very walkable to downtown. So those are the things that we kind of look at in terms of service area and what makes sense from zoning and accessibility and how we want to build networks to those places, if it's bike paths or walking paths or potentially new streets. This other map on this side is more about walking distance from our commercial district, not necessarily Main Street itself, but all the little streets that also make up Main Street. So it's a much bigger area that's a quarter mile walk is the red, and this bluish green is a half mile. And it's pretty consistent with our zoning district now that has the highest density residential allowances. But the goal is really to expand and create livable and walkable neighborhoods, so we need to look at this network and those systems. And then a little bit about resiliency and durability. We had one of the first LEED buildings, commercial buildings, certainly for a gold Taco Bell. But you'd wonder, is fast food really, is it really resilient and is it really sustainable? And it's, you all have seen fast food restaurants come and go and buildings come and go on King Street. This may not be around in 2030. I mean, I don't know of any plans to take it down, but it's certainly one of those things that turns over. So when we look at this, and it's great that we have third-party reviews of sustainable buildings and green buildings and things like that, but this compared to this, and I know Tris was very involved in the moving of this house, this is an old house, and it's still going to be here in 2030 because it was retrofitted, renovated. Yes, it was moved, but it's still standing. And potentially we'll have another move coming forward if Smith College can pull off the sale of the house that they're trying to move. So, you know, in terms of resiliency as well, we've altered the zoning along rivers, major river corridors in Northampton. That's what these dark squiggly lines are. To really expand the no-build zone. So we've moved up from the 100-year flood plain restriction for building to 500-year, because we know that these floodplain boundaries are changing, and we know some areas that have already really changed. They haven't been officially mapped by FEMA, but it doesn't make sense to put people in harm's way when we know that there's change down the road. And just a little bit about that, I think it's kind of interesting that, you know, we had another one of these huge rainfall events, but we're anticipating, well, the prediction is 85% more rain and water in New England based on climate change. And that's, this is the darkest color of this map, and, you know, the other areas, many other areas are drought areas, but New England is going to get a significantly more amount of rain. And so we really need to be thinking about that in all of this context, in transportation, providing opportunities for people, providing housing for people, and open space.
Is that more rain, or is that more extreme weather?
It's extreme rainstorm and snowstorm frequency. So, you know, as an example, we used to, you know, typically and for decades, we've been planning for storm events that are referred to as 2-year storm events, 10-year storm events, 25-year storm events. And it's over a 24-hour period. So 2 years, maybe 2 inches, over 24 hours. But just this spring, we've had 2 or 3 rainfall within an hour, and we've gotten 2 inches. And so that's the kind of thing that is going to become more prevalent. So that's the kind of thing we're talking about, is sort of these. And, you know, it's all coming at once. It's not spread out over 24 hours. And these are just other trend lines that are showing that, you know, if there weren't any climate change, it would sort of continue along here, but we're already, you know, going up. And this is a project I was talking to you briefly about, sort of our next big overall sort of mini plan for Northampton, sort of how do we address the gateway of Pleasant Street. And I hope it won't take till 2030 either. But again, we're starting the planning phases now, and parts of it will take a long time. We've got, some of it doesn't have anything to do with the city, but it's just market realities. A lot of these properties are privately owned, and people aren't interested in doing anything with them just yet, or maybe there's an economic downturn and there really isn't a possibility. So we go through these cycles, obviously. So it's not that even if we wanted it to happen in 5 years, that it could necessarily happen in 5 years. But we did public outreach, and we see that, you know, people on Pleasant Street and in the broader community want more trees. That was the biggest issue for Pleasant Street. And how do we make it a gateway? How do we make it more pleasant? But adding trees and green space also meets goals for sustainability in terms of being able to capture and hold that rainwater. It also provides an opportunity to create more friendly walking experiences for people, so people will want to walk from the abutting neighborhoods. And, you know, we see a high demand for increased and improved crosswalks, which fits into our goals of trying to create complete streets so that people who live adjacent to this corridor can easily walk and cross the street where they want to go. So we're actually applying for a grant at the end of the summer, hoping to kickstart some improvements to Pleasant Street. If we're successful in the grant, then we will start to see changes because we have to be shovel ready by next year. So there might be some minor modifications that we can do in the near term, and then hopefully that will just spur interest and potentially allowance or benefit for applying for future grants to try to help that along. We also know that there are 2 big properties in play on Pleasant Street, the Lumber Yard and the Northampton Lodging, that will see change in terms of the number of units, housing units that will come, and also the change on the street, what it will look like in terms of form, and how we can take that opportunity to have buildings that are more consistent with the fabric of downtown in terms of being close to the street. Creating that energy on the street that then might spur adjacent development or changes in the uses. So all of that takes time, but we know that there are a couple of pieces that are in play that might, you know, start to really transform the Pleasant Street corridor and make it a vibrant place. And then I just finished with sort of, I didn't really talk too much about sense of place and character. 2 of these are from Northampton, 2 of them are not. but, you know, the other piece of and all of this in urban form and character and sustainability is to create a place that we continue to love and create space that's unique to Northampton. So when people come on the train from New York and they stop in Northampton, they say, oh, isn't this fun? We had this great little, sandbox in the middle of Main Street, which is not Northampton, because it was that special weekend that they do once a year, or what have you. And then just really sort of creating more gateway interest, so that when people are driving through and they're getting off 91 and they say, okay, I need a Coke or something, they get there and they say, oh, there's a place here. So that's it for what I have to say.
Jenna, could you turn the light on up there? Thank you so much. We have time to take questions.
The historic Mill River restoration project, is there any movement on that? Because that would be, you know, Army Corps of Engineers flood control as well as enhancing the downtown with water. Is that going anywhere?
Well, periodically we check in when there's a grant opportunity to say, you know, how much. I think the big issue is it would take a huge amount of effort to break the dike at Route 66 in order to create that flow back into the river. So the old stream bed. So Tris is talking about the which is right now a stormwater ditch, for lack of a better word, but it runs along the bike path downtown behind the old the roundhouse building, and runs along Veterans Field. So that was the old Mill River corridor and runs through downtown and then back out to crossing Pleasant Street there, actually, where that photo was taken. And we've talked a lot about sort of opening that up for recreational use and just sort of a park-like feature for downtown. But it it would entail Army Corps agreeing that it would be a safe thing and an appropriate thing to open the dike to let that flow in. So.
Well, you could keep the dike, but just, you know, run it from a pipe from Paradise Pond, run it from a pipe, and then have it a valve. You could control the level of the water.
Right.
Without changing the river flow, you'd just be taking water and running it through a new path. Is that part of the discussion? Or
well, yeah, I mean, it's sort of still floating in the background. So
yeah.
The way these projects work, as you probably know, is that, you know, we have ideas, we have partially designed projects, and we look for opportunities to seek resources to, to realize those. And so that's still there in the back burner. We've knocked on the door several times, and Army Corps isn't really that interested.
No.
I mean, and frankly, my guess is that they've got a lot bigger fish to fry now that there have been all these major catastrophic events across the country. They need to focus their energies on post-Katrina redevelopment and places like that.
My question is, basically, what I would like to see, personally, and I don't know how this would go with the city, but as we talk about an aging population, wind up with more people using wheelchairs.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would be really nice if we could make downtown Northampton overall, more accessible to wheelchairs.
Yep.
So, for example, there are many places downtown that have one step up to get into the building. And I'd like to wonder what can be done to allow people who use chairs to get into those buildings. I also have a question about, you talked about the raised bike paths going around. Now, is that going to also be for use with wheelchairs?
Well, I'll start with that question first. The idea is that would be for bicyclists within the road network, so it wouldn't necessarily be continuous, but we might have two or three blocks of it to sort of create this more visibility for cyclists. But more to your point, we've also, in terms of, that doesn't mean that we're, I guess just say on the sidewalk side of it, we've also increased our standard widths for sidewalks to not be 3 feet, but to be wider in order to accommodate wheelchairs and pedestrians. The other piece of that also is, you know, I talked about a lot, how much real estate is allocated for cars on Main Street and many other streets, but certainly on Main Street, the pedestrian path is, there's a a lot of competition for that space, and I think there are lots of places on Main Street, never mind the step up into the businesses, where it's hard for wheelchairs, and you probably know all of them, but it's hard for wheelchairs and those businesses to coexist because there's just not enough sidewalk space. So we certainly want to make sure that we're widening spaces for folks.
Right, and I mean, the fact is that we treat cars more gently than we treat people. Riding on sidewalks is a mess. Because when you use a wheelchair, you feel every bump.
Yeah.
And
right.
Those bumps are all over the place. So I try to stay on the street as much as possible.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that we've talked about, and is, again, it's the incremental approach, is when anyone's doing redevelopment of a property, or maybe adding units, and in this case, my example would be residential units, we're going to ask, and we have been asking each applicant to look at the public space in front of their building. Is it safe and usable? If it's not, then you need to upgrade to the current standard. So if, you know, the sidewalks are like this and the panels are shifted, then you have to take those out and rebuild them so that it's level. So we have a regulatory mechanism for that, but it is slow unless we're going in as a city and rebuilding a street. Then, of course, if we do that, we're going to make it right, hopefully.
This is a little bit of a pet peeve, but since we're talking about accessibility, the pedestrian crossing at King Street, bike crossing.
Yeah.
In order to hit the crosswalk sign, you have to go across, you know, it's opposite, like, traffic.
You put it backwards.
Yeah.
You mean that was like a mistake?
Yes. An expensive mistake. Yes. Yeah.
Well, just over the years, I've had the opportunity to work with and look at a lot of different small towns throughout the United States, and particularly older towns, historic buildings, and all of that. And my observation is that there are probably 10,000 cities this size in the United States that would kill to have the vibrant economy of downtown Northampton. So that leads into my question, which is that so much of the planning, so much of what you're talking about is in response to development, sort of reactionary. I'm wondering what sort of emphasis is being placed on economic development, attracting new housing, new business, new industries, and all of that. And in particular, having moved here 10 years ago in retirement, if there's a push to market the fact that Northampton is a vibrant retirement community and create housing for that rather lucrative market in this world.
Well, we have, this goes back to the incremental effects too. We have over time, and going back 15 years since I've been here, 15 years, changed the regulatory allowances, so changed zoning in particular to allow more types of businesses in the central business district and in some of the other business districts in terms of economic development. And increase the height allowances over that time. We've done things to, essentially, we've changed the framework to make it easier for someone to come in and either rebuild or build new in the commercial district. So from a business standpoint, we've tried to set the stage for that. And again, then it's almost like a partnership. The private sector has to say, okay, I'm ready to go, or I have this opportunity to do this, or I have the financing to do this because the market is just right. So we try to set it up so that when the market is right, that will happen. In terms of housing, we've also been trying to do that in the most recent changes in terms of the housing, in terms of the residential districts that immediately surround downtown, which are important in that quarter, half, three-quarter mile ring, where we really want to encourage housing. We've altered the zoning to allow for that, and also allow for more housing density right in downtown. And we've done that recently as well. So I can't answer the questions about marketing, but you could check with the Chamber of Commerce.
My question is related to this one. I grew up in the area. Now I'm one of the New Yorkers that comes down on occasion, and and you do see the changes in Northampton as being incredible. And for those of you who live here and have continued to live here, to see the bike paths and to see the continued vibrancy is amazing. And whether the question is about marketing or it's about economic development, some of it may be, you know, what is the vision for Northampton as a place? And I think the very tangible things you clearly are addressing, you know, how you get to places, the connectivity and building the density. So I'm curious about some of those questions which may be related to sectors that, you know, people will wind up working in, and whether it's tied to the colleges in the area. What is it that's going, because we know that it could be marketed as an attractive place for retired people.
Right.
But what are some of the things that Northampton wants to become, in addition to being such an attractive kind of market town and place for older people? And what else might happen here?
Well, we have looked at sort of what our base sort of business sectors are, and we have. You know, we think healthcare is a really big sector that will only grow. And so we've actually made some modifications to our regulations to allow more of that and allow some of the zoning restrictions that had previously been in place don't necessarily accommodate medical uses the way they are now, with changing technologies and needing sort of bigger spaces and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
We know that we've done some work on trying to attract tech industries. We have a pretty small sector in that regard. I mean, the 128 corridor has a pretty big pull for that, so we can't really compete with Eastern Mass, I think, on those terms.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe there's a little bit of biotech, especially with the Mass. From a planning perspective, I'm sorry. I'm reaching my cup. Yes, please. So I guess I would say we're aware of that. We know we need to create job development.
Yeah.
And that's always been sort of the lagging piece, but always high demand. I mean, it's hard to find a job in Northampton unless you sort of in a couple of key, you know, education.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, it's a problem that we're trying to work on. So I don't know if I answered your question.
I think I heard the term shovel ready.
Shovel ready.
Shovel ready? Oh.
Yeah. Meaning you're ready to start the project.
Oh, okay.
That's the term of art.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. James.
I just want to say thank you, Carolyn, for this very nice presentation, and also for the incredibly hard work over so many years that you and the rest of the staff in planning and sustainability have been engaging in to keep our city not only livable but also model for the rest of the country and the world. And, you know, I think about some of the examples that we like to draw on. For instance, you know, I do a lot of bike advocacy, and I often point to Copenhagen, which is consistently voted one of the most livable places in the world, the number one most livable city. They have a city policy of removing 3% of their parking per year and turning it back into exactly what you were talking about, into cafe space, into green space, into livable spaces. So I like very much the message and the vision that you've talked about today of you know, taking the big picture, looking at the 50% of downtown that's paved for parking and driving and reallocating it for things that will continue to make Northampton such a wonderful, livable place. Think about New York City, which I've heard some people, apparently a lot of people, actually like living there, and it's getting better and better. Think about Times Square and Herald Square, which used to have 5 lanes of traffic, and now they're turned into pedestrian space. They're some of the most popular parts of the cities. And Northampton has to go on that list now, so thank you.
Well, if I could just piggyback on that, sort of thinking about reallocating the 50% of the parking spaces, let's say in downtown, and sort of of what we've done to encourage development, to Bruce's point, you know, we've taken away the requirements for parking downtown Northampton, so that maybe in the hopes that some, you know, we're setting the stage for some of these big surface parking lots to be converted to buildings, and maybe doing, you know, potentially, if there's a demand, underground parking, or maybe just using this public parking instead. So we've set the regulatory framework up for that, and we're just, you know, essentially wait, and I'll just sort of bring up the Yes Computers building, which now we can call the Yes Computers building. It used to be Silent Cows. But for the longest time, it was just that one little bar in the bottom of that building, and the rest of it was sort of decaying around it, and that was a big block on Pleasant Street. And it just took, you know, time for the property owner to say, okay, I'm ready to sell. And then that, just that building itself, I think has, along with some of the renovations of the buildings across the street, has sort of renewed or encouraged that mm-hmm. push down Pleasant Street. So that's sort of the next economic development piece that I think we'll see. But again, it's not just what the city can do, it's sort of what property owners, when they're ready to go.
Can this year, does zoning code allow some of the more creative ways to incorporate parking in the building where you have several levels of parking and then commercial or retail space above it, so it's actually built into the building?
Yeah, so you can
go that way.
Right.
Because that saves a lot of surface area.
Yeah. It's expensive.
Yes. Yeah. But someday the market will drive itself there.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we're hoping to have such a project soon, but mm-hmm. I don't know. We'll have to wait for more.
Is there a challenge reconciling increasing density downtown with flood control, stormwater control? Because theoretically, you are going to increase impervious surface.
Well, we already have, in terms of downtown, there's already a lot of impervious surface. So in many cases, it's going to be a conversion, so one impervious for another. The other piece of it is, I guess the short answer is no, I don't think it's going to necessarily create that. I think the other piece of it is the way we might actually be creating, in some cases, we might create more green space as we have the ability to go taller, we might not need such a big footprint, and that will leave more space on the site for absorption.
Looking at the future of planning, and I guess outside of the city center, more at the suburbs, has the increased cost of road material, asphalt, and cost of maintaining roads affecting how you're planning? Because it seems like our suburbs, the roads aren't sustainable. We see them crumbling more and more every year. We're not going to be able to maintain those. How is that? What are the suburbs going to look like in 20, 30 years?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, we can't stop maintaining what's already there and what's, you know, their neighborhoods there being served by those roads. I think the issue is, do we want to build more or allow more to be built, more infrastructure to be built? Because that just will add to that cost equation. I think by 2030, I don't think much will change in that regard, except that we'll have probably more development on existing infrastructure closer to town as opposed to building new roads for new subdivisions in the outlying area. The other piece of it is we're, through regulations, we're trying to minimize the dimensions of those road networks so that it will be less pavement when you build a new road. There will still be costs associated with it, but you know, it's a good question. Obviously, there are suburbs around the country that have totally gone belly up. They're, you know, they were half built or maybe built, and then people are moving out of them, and the road, the infrastructure is crumbling, literally crumbling. I hope, certainly by 2030, I don't see that happening for some of the outlying neighborhoods. But I guess I would say we would try to discourage more construction or new construction of new road networks because the cost will always be